Y'all. All right. On this spring morning, we remember how people gathered in the streets of Jerusalem long ago as they were preparing to celebrate the great festival of the Passover, and word had come that Jesus, perhaps the Messiah, was arriving in the city. And so there was much excitement as they cut palm branches from the trees to welcome him and acclaimed him with shouts of Hosanna. And with that vision in our hearts, we begin this Palm Sunday liturgy. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
This is the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When they were approaching Jerusalem and Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Hey, why are you doing this?' just say, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here immediately.' Then they went and found the colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to him, 'What are you doing untying that colt?' They told him what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it. He sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, 'Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our creator, ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest.' Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. We praise you, O God, for redeeming the world through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Today he entered the holy city in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. Bless these branches and those who carry them. Grant us grace to follow our Lord in the way of the cross, so that, joined to his death and resurrection, we enter into life with you. Through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Let us go forth in peace. In the name of Christ. Christ. Amen. Amen. Turn toward the sanctuary. If you have the crosses, come up with us, please.
Oh, thank you, sir.
All right. We'll stop right here. Whoa, stop. All right, very good. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
If you're carrying a cross, go to the front. Go to the front. Go to the front.
Don't hang up here with the crosses. Yeah.
Come
on. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. From God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace and peace be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Everlasting God, in your endless love for the human race, you sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take on our nature and to suffer death on the cross. In your mercy, enable us to share in his obedience to your will and in the glorious victory of his resurrection. He who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Again, we welcome all who worship on this day of Palm Sunday, the Sunday of our Lord's Passion, all who are here in the sanctuary, a number of folks in the parking lot, and various folks online from wherever you may be this morning. We are truly blessed to gather on this beginning of the holiest week of our lives as followers of Jesus. because this is the beginning of Holy Week. We really stay in worship throughout this entire week. There are times we gather for worship here together in this place, and then when we're not here, we're in constant worship throughout the week as well. Just a reminder of some of the gatherings here. This afternoon at 2 p.m., one of the 2 days, there's a public walking of the cross is on Palm Sunday as well as Good Friday. But at 2 p.m., we'll gather on the lawn with our friends from Northeast Methodist. We'll begin with prayers here. I'll be walking the cross down Hardscrabble until we get to Northeast Methodist. We'll stop along the way for prayers and readings, the traditional stations of the cross, and we'll have shuttles back here as well. So that's this afternoon at 2 o'clock. There's also walking of the cross on Good Friday. It'll begin at 9 a.m. That's the hour that Jesus was nailed to the cross. And on Good Friday morning, we'll begin in Harmony Assisted Living up Clemson Road, about 3/4 of a mile. We'll have devotions and prayers with some of the residents there, and then walk the cross on Clemson Road back here and conclude with prayers. A little shorter walk on Friday morning, but both are very powerful experiences, and pray that they can be a part of your Holy Week discipline. Our worship times on Holy Monday tomorrow at 12 and 7, we begin with the traditional service of healing and blessing, when we all come and just ask for God's healing and wholeness in our lives, whatever form that needs to take for each of us. So that's Monday, noon and 7. On Monday, Friday, we also worship at noon and 7, prior on Monday, Thursday at noon and 7, prior to the 7 o'clock service. There'll be the opportunity for the rite of foot washing. We'll be gathered at the base of the baptismal font, can come early or stay after the 7 o'clock service. And then on Good Friday, in addition to the walking of the cross that morning, there's the solemn service of the Tenebrae, the reading of the last words which Jesus spoke from the cross, and that's at 7 p.m. on Good Friday evening. And then our Easter celebrations begin on Holy Saturday night at 7:30, the Easter Vigil service. Sunrise service will be Sunday morning at 7, with worship at 8:15 and 10:30. Between the 8:15 and 10:30, Lutheran men are providing Easter breakfast in the fellowship hall. And then after the 10:30 service around noon, we have the wonderful egg hunt on the lawn for children and youth. So a lot of celebration happening on Easter weekend as well. We give thanks. So many people were packing. We had 140 food bags. We're packing this morning. Might check the fellowship hall to make sure if you want to go through the line and assemble a bag or two. That's a great blessing for our school children, as well as the blessing bags. Rush hour, we were not able to do last week because they closed down a little bit of this section for road widening. So it'll be Tuesday afternoon at 5. And if you really want to, that wonderful experience of sharing joy with those lined up in traffic and just see smiles on faces as we hand those affirmation bags of blessing, that'll be Holy Tuesday around 5 o'clock. Your palms, just a reminder to take those home with you, to put them in some symbolic place where you see them during the week. As they begin to dry out during the week, you'll be reminded of the shouts of Hosanna that were transformed into shouts of crucify him by the end of the week, and that'll be the symbolic as they begin to dry out. And then hang on to your palm, and then next Shrove Tuesday, we'll bring them back for the burning of the palms that will make the ashes for Ash Wednesday. So I pray that they'll be meaningful for you to see them throughout the year until we begin the Lenten journey next year. A few prayer updates. Sherry Forsgren began her chemotherapy treatments this week, so please keep Sherry in your prayers for the weeks ahead. Sylvia Hurlbut moved from Rice Estate to memory care at the Watercrest right around the corner. So please keep Sylvia and the Hurlbut family in your prayers. We're overjoyed at the safe arrival of Henry Bennett Pittman. And please keep the Pittman family in your prayers of joy as well, in addition to all those listed in the bulletin. I think that may be it. Moment of thanksgiving. Anyone? Moment of thanksgiving, we just give thanks for all the ways we've seen God at work through the Lenten Fish Fry series, met our goal of $4,000 for Luther Campus Ministry. What a tremendous blessing that is. It brings hope into so many of the young people on our college campuses. And give thanks for many who endured the rain on several nights and just came out to be a part of that and to give of yourselves in meaningful ways so that lives can be touched, many young lives who need affirmation and hope as they go through those college years away from home and others. Thanks be to God. This time we invite our children, youth, and young at heart to come and gather on the steps for Palm Sunday message. So it's great to be here on Palm Sunday. Just an amazing, amazing day to wave our palm branches and shout Hosanna and give praise to God. So when you have your palm branches in the air, we're reminded in a minute the service is just going to change, and we're going to go from shouts of joy to Hosanna, and things will get very quiet as we hear the story being read of Jesus going to the cross. So behind you, I put something here. If you look behind you right here, all right, what do you see up there? Right back here. Everybody turn this way and look. What do you see back here? Nobody sees anything? All right. What do we see back here? Jesus. Jesus in the manger with Mary and Joseph when he was born, right? We might not think so many things happened during Jesus' life, even the joy at Christmas when he was born with the shepherds and the angels, and then the Magi came when he was a couple years old, and all those things were happening. And then he grew up, and he walked everywhere, and he went places, and he shared God's love, and he helped people and healed people. And all those places he went, many people never even thought about the cross, right? He tried to tell folks maybe three times, but folks were just excited about everything that was happening with Jesus. But all along the way, if you look at where I put the picture, which direction's he looking over here? Toward the cross, right? Even though everything was happening and all this celebration and wonderful things were going on, even back to when he was born as a baby, Jesus was always looking at the cross in his heart, because he knew that's why he had come into the world, right? And everywhere he went, he was always headed toward the cross, right? So when we came in this morning and we shouted Hosanna with our palm branches, the people there might have not thought anything about a cross, but even when Jesus was coming in on the donkey, he knew he was headed to that cross, right? And that's why today, in a minute, we're gonna read the story, the most important story of all our lives, how Jesus never, never, never forgot why he came and why he was here, that he was going to the cross to spread his arms and show God's love for everyone, right? And that's important because when we start our journey of faith with the water of baptism, do you remember what we put on our foreheads? We put a cross, right? And people may not see that either, right? Just like people didn't see the cross when Jesus was doing all this stuff. But the cross is always there because it reminds us God put us here for a purpose too, right? To always share and live out the love which Jesus shared and lived out. Even being able to give everything we have out of love for others when they need it most, like he did on the cross, right? So today we go home with a palm. Make sure you take a palm home with you. But in a minute, I'm going to give you a little cross, all right? And you hold on to that cross, and you put it somewhere special. And every time you see your palm and your cross, remember the cross that's on your forehead that nobody sees when you go to school or daycare or other places. But it's always there, right? It's always there, just like the cross was always there for Jesus, even when others never even thought about it, okay? All right. Okay. All right. So let's bow our head and fold our head. Dear Jesus, thanks for being so loving and always keeping your heart and eyes on your cross of love, Always help me remember the cross that is in my life, that I may never forget my purpose, to share your love with others, Amen.
Amen.
Okay. All right. So when you head back, one way we share our love is with our coins and dollars for the bucket. They're helping people who don't have enough food or things that they need in life. All right. And so when you come, I've got sheets with words on you, words to look for during the reading today, and a cross for everyone too, okay? So you know, if you come by here, I'll give you a sheet and your words, okay?
A reading from Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Word of God, word of life.
Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and a world in need. Blessed One, Today, the church sings glad hosannas as we enter Holy Week. Prepare us to bear witness to Christ's suffering and death endured for our sake. Gather your people around the cross and comfort us with resurrection hope. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Renew your good creation and protect the balance of life on earth. Encourage the work of foresters, scientists, arborists, gardeners, and river keepers. We pray for the health of pollinating insects, songbirds, and native plants. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Establish peace and justice among the nations. Hold to account any with authority to judge others. Grant that courts, legislators, and local governments will serve with integrity and compassion. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Bring hope to any who feel forsaken or forgotten. Make a way for those fleeing violence. Reunite families enduring separation. Sustain all those who are suffering, ill, or grieving. We pray especially for Sherry Forsgren,
Sherry.
Midge Gunvalson,
Midge.
Evan Turnmeyer,
Evan.
Sarah Hale,
Sarah.
Chuck Kaufman,
Chuck.
Steve and Anita Dye, LaVon Griffin,
LaVon.
Wendy McKenzie,
Wendy.
Brady Stoutland,
Brady.
Anne Duquette,
Anne.
Roger Schwind,
Roger.
Dolores Harmon,
Dolores.
Marguerite Zakur,
Marguerite.
Irene and Charlie Tracy,
Irene and
Lee Maloney,
Lee.
Bill Vanskoy,
Bill
Grigby,
Bill.
Mara,
Mara,
Joe Schmidt,
Joe.
Olivia Shreve,
Olivia.
Linda Roberts,
Linda.
Stuart Washington,
Stuart.
Charles Shank,
Charles.
The Link family,
the
Lindsay and Brandon, and Henry and Bennett Pittman, and all we name before you silently or aloud. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Give energy and joy to our pastors, deacons, worship leaders, and musicians. Bless baptismal candidates, their sponsors, confirmands, and teachers. Watch over those who travel. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
O Blessed One, our times are in your hand. Sustain us in discipleship throughout our lives, and receive us into everlasting life. We give thanks for the courage of Oscar Arnolfo Romero, bishop and martyr whom we commemorate today. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Accompanying us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen. On this day of Palm Sunday, the Passion of our Lord, our hearts now turn to the reading of Christ's Passion. We read this story every year along with Christians around the world to remind us that this is the story that shapes our lives, so that when things are happening, when we go through things, when we experience things, the first thing that comes through our mind is not, oh, I remember when this happened in some movie I saw. I remember some book I read. I remember something I saw on TV. It's, I remember this story. And this is the story that defines how we see ourselves, how we see the world, how we see God's love for us. And so this story is not only something in a bulletin, but it's something that's in our hearts. And we know it by heart. And it defines everything we are and everything we do. The story is not so much meant to make us ask, why did people back then do these things? How could they have rejected Jesus? How could they? Because it is we who are in the story. And so when we pick words, when we say words together, when we hear folks rejecting, abandoning, it is there to remind us that this is us in the story. And how many times do we boldly proclaim, we'll never abandon the Lord, and yet when it comes to it, we make something else more important in our lives, or we pursue our own goals, or we do whatever we do, or we're afraid to mention that we follow Jesus, or we become silent when we should speak up against injustice in the world, whatever it may be. And so those who are in the story are us. But most importantly, who is in the story is Jesus. And in spite of everyone else's letting him down, Jesus remains faithful. Jesus remains faithful. And it is love, it is his strength, it is his commitment, it is forgiveness, his sacrifice that is still there for us, for each and every one of us every day, to give us strength to follow Jesus in the way of the cross and to live out his love for others, and let that be the defining purpose of our lives. So now we turn to the reading of Christ's Passion.
It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him, for they said,
not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people.
While Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard, and she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger,
why was this ointment wasted in this way? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii, and the money given to the poor.
And they scolded her. But Jesus said,
let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish. But you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her.
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat Passover?
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, the teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. make preparations for us there.
So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had been told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
"Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and to say to him one after another,
"Surely not I."
He said to them,
"It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said,
"Take, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God."
In the night in which Jesus was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after they had supped, he took the cup and gave it to them to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant shed in my blood for the forgiveness of all sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Gathered into one and by the Holy Spirit, let us pray in the way Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Bled for the journey, a feast for hungry hearts. The table is set. Come. Thank you.
Let us stand. Generous God, at this table we have tasted your immeasurable grace. As grains of wheat are gathered into one bread, now make us one loaf to feed the world. In the name of Jesus, the bread of life. Amen. Amen.
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all become deserters, I will not."
Jesus said to him,
"Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But he said vehemently,
"Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you."
And all of them said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciple,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter and James and John, and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them,
"I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake."
And going a little further, Jesus threw himself on the ground and prayed that, if it were all possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
"Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want."
He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak."
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more Jesus came and found them sleeping, for the eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
"The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard."
So when he came, he went up to him and at once said,
"Rabbi,"
and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near him drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day, I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled."
All of them deserted him and fled. a certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priest and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many men gave false testimony against him, and the testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying, but even at this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
"Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?"
But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
"Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said,
"I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"Why do you still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?"
All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him, "Prophesy." The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below the courtyard, one of the serving girls at the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said,
"You also was with Jesus, the man from Nazareth."
But he denied it, saying,
"I do not know or understand what you are talking about."
And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed. And the serving girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
But again he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter,
"Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean."
But he began to curse, and he swore an oath,
"I do not know this man you're talking about."
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." And he broke down and wept.
Thank you.
As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered him,
"You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"You have no answer. See how many charges they bring against you?"
But Jesus made no further reply, so the Pilate was amazed. Now, at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priest had handed him over. But the chief priest stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again,
"Then what do you wish for me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted back,
"Crucify him."
Pilate asked them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed him in purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began saluting him,
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place they call Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Aha! You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying,
"He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lima sabachthani,
which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of the bystanders heard it, they say,
listen, he is calling for Elijah.
And someone ran, filled with a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
wait, let us see whether Elijah will come down to take him down.
Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtains of the temples was torn in two, from the top to bottom. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who had stood facing him saw that in his way he breathed his last, he said,
truly, this was God's son.
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James the younger and of Joses and Salome. These used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he was already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. When Joseph bought a linen cloth and taken down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth, and laid it in the tomb that had been hewn out of the rock, he then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, life of the world to come. Amen.
Beloved, we are God's own people, holy washed, renewed. God bless you and keep you and shower you with mercy, fill you with courage, and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen.